Good morning and welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday after Epiphany. I think it's some other printed forms you might have, it says fourth, but it is actually the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. I'm glad you can join us on Facebook or YouTube or reading this worship service at your home. Thank you for continuing to support the mission of First English with your gifts and offerings. And a brief announcement about COVID and worship. With vaccines slowly being distributed, some questions have come about when we might return to in-person worship. We here at First English are following the guidelines and the guidance of the Wisconsin Council of Churches and their team of experts, which include medical doctors and epidemiologists. We are also monitoring the Marathon County Health Department and their COVID statistics. Last fall, our bounce back team recommended and council agreed that when Marathon County was a medium COVID transmission county for 2 to 4 weeks, we would return to worship. As of this recording, on Thursday early afternoon, Marathon County is a very high COVID county. So the numbers are falling, which is good, but it might take some time before we get to the medium range. And it is hard to be patient. We all want to be together again. But a reminder, the building may be closed, but the church never is, never was. The church is you and the ministry you do every day. The church is quilters quilting at home. The church is your donations to Open Door and the Lutheran World Relief. The church is you providing community suppers at First Presbyterian. The church is you caring for your coworkers and neighbors. The church is you writing cards and letters and emails to friends and family. The church is you baking cookies and dropping them off at someone's doorstep. So the building may be closed, but the church is you, and the church is never closed. Jesus commands us to love our neighbor, and part of that command is to make sure we keep each other and ourselves and our health professionals as safe as possible. When we do return to worship in person, we will continue to follow the health and safety protocols recommended by the health experts. So with all that said, it's time for worship. Let's continue with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out on all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know all our ways. We confess our hearts are burdened by our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust people unlike us. We exploit the earth and its resources, failing to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Amen. How vast is God's grace. Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away. We are claimed as God's own beloved, and we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out justice, reconciliation, and peace. Amen. We sing our gathering hymn, Gather Us In, hymn 532, number 532.
We are the
Continue with our call to worship, Psalm 147. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Hallelujah. How good to sing God's praise. How lovely the sound. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem and gathers the exiles of Israel, healing the brokenhearted, binding their aching wounds. God fixes the number of stars, calling each by name. God, great is our God and powerful, wise beyond all telling. The Lord upholds the poor, but lets the wicked fall. Sing thanks to the Lord. Sound the harp for our God. The Lord stretches the clouds, sending rain to the earth, clothing the mountains with green. The Lord feeds the cattle and young ravens when they call. A horse's strength, a runner's speed, they count for nothing. The Lord favors the reverent, those who trust in God's mercy. Hallelujah. We pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading is from the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah 40, 21 through 31. The Judeans in exile have a good reason to be hopeful. The one who will bring them to freedom is the God who created the world, the God who subdues the rulers of the earth and gives strength to those who are weary. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. No one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Mark 1, verses 29 to 39. Everywhere Jesus goes, many people expect him to set them free from oppression. Everywhere he goes, he heals people and sets them free. Disease, devils, and death are running for their lives. The forces that diminish human life are rendered powerless by Jesus. Mark 1, beginning at verse 29. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. The fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. The whole city was gathered around the door. Jesus cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Time for the children's sermon.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Do you ever get tired? Of course, yeah, right? And we are busy all day, school and playing, and then that comes and we're ready to lie down and go to sleep. Sometimes we even need a nap in the middle of the day to help us not be so tired. In the words of my son Caleb, naps are glorious. And it's true, they are. But how about this? Do you ever get tired of helping someone? I have 2 cups of water here. One is empty, and one has some water in it. When we help others, it takes some of our energy. So maybe you help your mom and dad clean the house, and that takes some energy. Maybe you take care of your little brother or sister. That takes some more energy. Maybe you help a friend with their schoolwork, and that takes the rest. You ever get tired of helping? You ever run out of energy? I know I do sometimes. So what do? We know we're supposed to help others, but sometimes we just don't have any energy to be good helpers. Well, Jesus shows us how we can recharge our energy and refill our cups. In our Bible story, I gotta put my glasses on, it's getting a little blurry on these words here. In our Bible story, Jesus spends a whole evening healing people who are sick. And he spends a lot of energy helping all these people. So what does he do the next morning? He gets up early. And he goes to a quiet place and he prays. He refills his cup by talking to God. We refill our cups by talking to God and being reminded that we are God's baptized children, that we are beloved of God, that God wants to hear from us. So we spend that time in prayer talking to God, and our cups are filled up again. And we can help. Now, we don't know exactly what Jesus said in his prayer to God, but he might have said something like, "Hey, God, it's me. I'm really tired from all the helping. Refill me with your strength and show me what to do and where to go and who to help next." And you know, that's not such a bad prayer for us. So let's pray. Hey, God, sometimes we get really tired of helping. Refill us with your strength. Show us what to do and where to go and who to help next. Amen. And the advantage of having these 2 cups of water is now I have water. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God, our Creator, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Imagine this happening to you. You walk into your workplace after lunch, and somebody is there. "Where have you been? Everyone is looking for you." And someone is waving 18 phone messages. Your email inbox is overflowing, and 11 people are lined up to talk, physically distanced in appropriate 6 feet spaces, right? What's the first thing you do? Well, when we lived in Burnhamwood, I took a course to become a first responder with the Burnhamwood Area Ambulance Service. And one thing they taught us in that course was triage. Identify the most serious injury, help that person, and then move on down the line. The next most serious need, and the next most, the next most, the next most. So when you're confronted with 18 messages, a full inbox, and 11 people, it's time for triage. Figure out what needs immediate attention. Talk to these 2 people, deal with that message, reply to this email, talk to 3 more people, return 4 calls, reply 3 emails, and you work your way through that list. Triage is prioritizing according to need and then getting to work. Or imagine this, you walk into your home. "Where have you been? Everyone's looking for you." One kid needs help with algebra. One kid is complaining he's hungry, and one is bleeding. So what do? Triage. You bandage the bleeder, give a cheese stick to the hungry kid, and tell algebra girl that when in doubt, X equals 2. Jesus is up and out early. Pray. The disciples find him and say, "Where have you been? Everybody's looking for you." And people are lined up at Simon's house, waiting to be healed and helped and comforted. What does Jesus do? It's time for triage, right? Does he figure out who needs him most? No. He's ready to move on to the next place. Let's go on to the neighboring villages so I can preach there too. That's why I'm here. So Jesus is ready to move on after getting up early and finding a quiet place to pray. And I'm a little confused with that. I mean, there's a lot of work to do in Capernaum. People are hurting and sick and possessed and lost and tired and sinking into despair. So don't you think Jesus should have skipped that early morning prayer session and opened the office early? Don't you think Jesus should have stuck around at least another day, maybe just the morning even, and helped more people? Why did he leave so quickly? I wonder, if Jesus was the senior rabbi at the synagogue, could he have gotten away with this? You can just hear the hushed voices of synagogue members talking after worship in the coffee hour, right? Is Rabbi Jesus slacking off? There's too much work to be done around here for Jesus to be off on his early morning prayer retreats. How can we make sure he's in the office more than he is now? Isn't that what we pay him for? Apparently not, I guess. But maybe Jesus is doing triage here, too. The people in the other villages are more in need of teaching and healing and hearing the good news of God's kingdom than the people in Capernaum. There are many things we can learn from this story. I'm going to focus on two. First, as incredibly important to the salvation of the world that Jesus' ministry was, it was not so important that Jesus didn't have time to perform triage on himself and to nurture his connection with God. He knew his energy was low, and he knew he needed that refill that God gave him. And if Jesus makes time for his connection to God, then you and I should certainly follow his example. Triage ourselves and make the time. I have a semi-important job and all, but I am not the savior of the world. So if the savior of the world needs quiet time alone to connect with God, then we do too. And second, Jesus shows us that you do not have to do it all. You cannot save everyone. Actually, you cannot even save anyone. That's the Spirit's job. And so sometimes triage means you pick up and you go where the Holy Spirit leads you, even if it means people still want to see you. There are always going to be people in need, but sometimes your gifts may be better used elsewhere. We may find this confusing and strange, and it is, because it's a totally different way to think about life and career and ministry and what God calls us to do and who God calls us to be. It shows us clearly that the world does not revolve around me or you. Shocking, I know, right? Finding a quiet place to connect with God, renewing our spiritual relationship, refilling our cups, gives us the energy to continue God's work with our hands and our hearts. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I play a lot of arrangements by Mark Hayes. This is an original work that he wrote a couple years ago. He simply titled it Faith.
For the prayers, I will end each petition with the words, "Let us pray," and your response is, "Have mercy, O God." For the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For creation, for insects in the grass, clouds on the mountaintops, for cattle and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community leaders, school officials, and CEOs, for international health organizations, in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, may they find freedom in service to people in need. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork and stress, and for all who cry out to you, we pray especially for Marion, Al, Liz, Jim, Dolores, Delbert, Kathy, Janie, Mary, Dave, Kay, Kathy, Natalie, Bonnie, Gary, Ron, Bruce, Kyle, Tom, and all with COVID-19. For medical researchers, hospital personnel, doctors and nurses, especially Deb, Holly, Joy, Kara, Taylor, Lily, Olivia, Todd, Reese, Pat, and Bonnie, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. O God, now hear the prayers of your people. In thanksgiving for the faithful departed, called by name and now resting from their labors, may their lives serve as witnesses to the goodness of God. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of Jesus, our Savior, who dwells among us. Amen. We pray. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us, like a mother receives her child, with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care, and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen. I realize I forgot to announce at the beginning of the service that we are having online Holy Communion today. So if you haven't got your communion stuff ready, you can press pause right now and then go get it and come back and press play, and you'll be right where we are right now. We'll get into the communion liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by God's Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. The body of Christ, given for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God, from whom are all things, and in whom we exist, we give you thanks that in this meal you have fed us with the presence of Christ. Use us as beacons of light and bearers of Christ's love for the sake of the whole world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We sing our closing hymn in 787, On Eagle's Wings. May the love of Jesus Christ, the light of the world, fill your hearts and illumine your path. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, share the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.